Hello there, lollygaggers. Another week on tap. We are Lollygagging Sports. I am Bo Reed along with Samantha Button and Matthew Irby. We're going to be talking some central divisions tonight, both AL and NL, as we continue to gear up for the upcoming Major League Baseball season that Samantha starts in a week. I'm not counting the Seoul series.
This isn't a real game. It's exhibition.
Is it, though? Is it?
Wait, is it a real game? It is not a real game.
Sure it is. It counts. Yeah, it counts. It's. I can't get behind this.
That doesn't make any... No. Do I have a veto?
If we did, that wouldn't be baseball and Seoul that counted.
That would be fine with me.
That's fine with me too. Yeah.
That's the goal. Yeah. This is ridiculous. If you're going to actually, I don't mind them doing this. You just need to do it like backed up against the actual season. You can't have games that count, spring training, games that count. This is a no for me.
Yeah.
You do this next week if you need to do this.
Yeah. They could be Monday, Tuesday and give the Dodgers and Padres both Thursday and Friday off and then they can resume on Friday.
Yeah.
Or Wednesday, Thursday off.
Yeah, give them that. Wouldn't they would play on the days when everybody else has their days off between spring training.
Yeah. And,
yeah, because this is the only one, right? This is the only series we have like this that counts.
Yes.
So why not just do that? Then I don't know. Because Irby, say your thing. say your thing about logic.
Logic, what, are you bringing too much logic to this equation? Or
see?
I think this series is crap.
Well, that would work also.
I'm not a fan of it either. Exactly the same reason, you know, that we have this and then there's a pause before we go at it again. I understand what you're doing. You kind of have to logistically do it this way. But at the end, they do count because, as we're learning, apparently you can bet on these games.
Oh, ooh.
You can bet on spring training games.
Ooh.
I just want to put that out there. If you're like a complete degenerate, you can bet on spring training games. Please, please don't bet on spring training games, guys. Please don't do that.
Can you do split squad games?
Probably. They will take your money.
Oh, see, I'm more of like a prop bet guy in spring training. Which players took the long bus trip to go play the Cubs?
It's okay. We don't have to bet on everything. Like, you could just not do this. You could just be like, hey, it's spring training, man. It's not real baseball. We don't need to gamble on it. Oh, my gosh.
What's the fun in that?
That doesn't sound fun to me at all. Like, I don't know, but I don't enjoy gambling of any sort. So, and maybe I'm just the wrong person but this feels like a bridge too far. Like, this is just full on degeneracy. Like, you're betting on games that don't count. Please stop.
Oh, boy. All right. Irby, how about you? How you doing, man?
I'm good. It's, you know, we got basketball, college version. It's ramping up here with teams that don't deserve to be in, but are trying to get in. Baseball is about to start. So excited. Got two more of these preview shows, and then we get real baseball because, as you were saying, Seoul baseball is kind of half baseball, but it is still baseball. So that's always good.
Would it be kind of cool if, like, if in the Seoul series they use the Japanese baseball? Bring it all together?
The Korean baseball.
Well, I'm trying to get all three involved. I know it's Seoul's in Korea.
Well, yes, I know you know.
Good. Just wanted to make sure that
I'm trying not at this age to be friends with people who don't know that Seoul is in Korea. Okay, good. Glad we got that out of the way. Everybody here knows what country Seoul is in. That's great.
Is there a difference between the Japanese ball and the Korean ball?
Yes.
There is. Ah,
the Korean ball is tackier. Yeah.
I didn't know that. So is it the same size?
I believe so.
Same size, just better stick. Interesting.
Yeah. It's got a tackier
stick. See, I didn't know that.
The more you know. I'm going to make the little rainbow thing.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, Irby mentioned basketball. Samantha, let's just for a second before we talk AO and NL Central, let's talk brackets because I have had a devil of a time filling my bracket out. Normally, I can get it done relatively easily, but the obscure universities that I have in the Sweet 16 is downright scary right now. I'm still playing with it, but I don't know. I'm not comfortable with how this bracket is shaking out.
Yeah, I'm with you. I think it's like a combination of I'm not the higher seeded teams are teams that I don't have a lot of faith in to actually be able to, like, you know, be worthy of their seeding. And I also don't really have a rooting interest in anyone who's involved. So, like, what am I supposed to do? I can't pick on, like, well, I'm going to will this to happen. And apparently I also can't pick on, like, hey, this makes sense. So, like, usually I try to do, like, blend of, like, okay, here's my safety net teams that I think will make it pretty far, and here's teams that I think it would be cool or interesting or that would be a fun upset or whatever. But this year I'm just like, I don't know, man. Like, I was tweeting about this yesterday. I was like, maybe I'm just, like, maybe I will throw my whole bracket out tonight and start over and pick based on the mascots. Like, I'm just going to look up a picture of the mascot of every team and seed them accordingly. Maybe I'll do that.
Did you do the music?
I did look through that. Yeah, I was, like, thinking about creating a second bracket using that. He had somebody went around. Irby's the one who found this, so credit to him. Somebody went around and asked every head coach what their favorite, you know, artist was. So I went through and picked between all of them. I did not, like, go on and do the next round or whatever, but I did go through and pick a winner based on their musical taste. And I have to tell you, there were a few where I had to abstain because I refused to vote for it.
Yes, that one had some interesting choices. Wow.
And there were a few things I'd never heard of, some of which I was, like, able to determine were probably, like, Christian rock bands. But, like, there were also some things that did not sound like they were a Christian rock band that I had not heard of. So, I don't know. There were a few where I was just like, listen, man, I don't know who you are. So, but anyway, it's not a bad way to pick, right? I'm not sure it's any worse than, like, actually trying to win based on, you know, past success rate for most of us.
Well, okay, that was going to be my question for Irby, because I know that in his household, picking using the mascots is quite popular. Can you do that with this field? I was wondering about that as I'm going through and not knowing half the schools.
Well, and were you using, Irby, just to clarify, were you using the mascots or, like, the team name? I was going for actual mascots, like the furry thing that stands on the court.
Oh, see, yeah, it's been interesting how, my boys, it's gone. Like, the elder one has went from logos. When he was a toddler, his favorite letter was W, so Wisconsin always did really well in his bracket. You know, it was a big red W. And he's a lot chalkier in his picks nowadays. Very calculated there. And then, but the younger one, Luke, he is hardcore nicknames. And his final four, he tries his best to have anything and everything related to Wolves. So we got Huskies, Lobos, Wolf Pack. Yeah, he's loving that. Also, big Bulldogs fan.
Mm.
He's all about Bulldogs. So
I like that. Yeah. That's good taste. I approve. It's a good choice.
I don't know. Okay, well, how are your brackets then, guys? Like, you're going to start. You're going to basically start over, right?
I'm thinking about it, yeah.
Yeah. Irby, how about you?
I weirdly go through a process of where I fill out multiple just so that I can then look at, like, how my mind is. After I've, like, read something or listened to a podcast and I fill out another one, and then I will take basically the average of all those and work from there what the final one is. So, but I'm with you. I'm not comfortable at all, so I'm confident in how my bracket's going to do, because any time that I've done a bracket and been like, yep, I like this one, number one loses right away.
You know, if there was ever a bracket that really needed the Irish treatment, it's this one, where I buy, mm-hmm. where I get a bottle of Jameson and a cigar, and when I'm done with both, then I pick.
I love how Irby has, like, this whole system where he's like, listen, I'm doing research, I'm building multiple brackets, then I'm going to average them together after I've thought it through several times, and then Bo and I are just like, I don't know. I'm going to have some drinks and see what happens.
And both of y'all will end up beating me this year.
But this is the problem with these things. Is like, there is no strategy. Like, you could do literally anything, and it probably wouldn't matter. You could try really hard. You could flip a coin. Like,
yeah, but when you do pick that one upset that, like, only 5% of everyone else picks,
yeah,
it just feels so good.
It sure does. It's so good. It's so good. And it doesn't even matter why. It's just the fact that it is. It's so good.
Oh, boy. All right. All right. All right. Anything else on basketball before we get into baseball, Samantha?
I don't think so. No. I've done a men's bracket. I've done a women's bracket. The women's bracket is much easier because it is far clearer who the good teams are. I don't know. But
who do you have winning the women's bracket?
Iowa.
Well, naturally.
Very boring. I hope I'm wrong. I have several teams I would like to see win it, but Iowa not being among those. But you know, it's chalk, man. It's so much easier to predict winners than that.
I mean, Iowa does have the best player in the world, and I'm talking men and women, guys. Like the best player in the world.
Yes, I agree.
So
I agree.
That's not a surprise. All right, Irby, how about you? Anything else on basketball before we get into baseball?
The Iowa's going to be fun to watch. I'm going homer on the women's side. Go Lady Longhorns. This is looking good. They can get it done. On the men's side, I'm going to put out there, I've told y'all this too, watch out. This might be the year for Gonzaga. All these years that they're a 1-2 seed, maybe as a 5, they finally stumble on there and get the job done finally. Who knows? Just as good of a chance as UConn. So, I don't know.
I will consider that in my chaos-based decision-making.
Cool. All right. Okay. Well, we're going to talk AL and NL Central. Friendly reminder that the projections we are using is FanGraphs. These were updated Wednesday, March 20th at 5 o'clock p.m. Eastern time, so about a couple hours before we actually recorded our podcast for this week. We do those on Wednesday nights as well. So we got some fresh projections here. So let's start off with that AL Central. In the arms of the angel, fly away. All right, we're not off our rocker, and we're not. We're not raising money for forgotten pets. No. The Twins are projected to win the AL Central this year with 84 wins. That's right, 84 wins for the Twins, who have no money. They need help. You know, they've got to, Samantha, they've got to support the German Shepherd leg in Correa somehow.
All right. If you guys weren't around, like, last year with the Correa x-rays, we were determining that the ankle probably looked backwards, like a German Shepherd ankle, right? But they gave him all of their money, hence the ASPC music. So they had to get rid of apparently everyone else, and which is weird because I do not think they were in exactly the same sort of like TV contract hell that, I'm sure they have some of that, but it was not nearly as dire as it was for like some teams. But anyway, they made a decision to cut payroll and then everyone got hurt. And that's why we're holding a funeral ASPCA style for Carlos, his German Shepherd ankle, and the Twins, who apparently are now a poverty franchise.
Yes. Do you think
Sarah and are not going to win this division? put that out there too.
You think Sarah McLachlan knew what that song was going to be when she released it?
I hope that she had no idea, or she wouldn't have done it. And yet she had to agree to license that song to them, right? Well, no, I guess she didn't have to. They just had to pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, man. I'd be super bummed out if I wrote a song and it ended up on the Sad Dog commercial. That would kind of ruin my own song for me. That would make me really depressed.
Yeah, they really need to rethink those commercials because, like, I can't watch that. I can't. I have to turn the channel.
Oh, I turn it off. Yeah, it's like this is not helping, and I am like an easy mark for dog charities. Like every time I see one of those like dog surgery Kickstarters, I'm like, oh, okay, sure. Take all my money. Like I'm a very easy mark. So like maybe don't like make me look at the most depressed dogs on earth, because I just turn it off. Cause like, I'm like you, I can't take it. I can't take it. It's probably how Twins fans are going to feel watching the Twins this season. Turn it off. I can't take it.
Turn it off. I can't watch this. And there's the actual tie-in to the song right there. Irby, what are your thoughts here on the Twinkies? 84 wins.
Well, I love the song here because that's kind of what, yeah, poor Twins fans watching their rotation and bullpen go through spring training. My gosh, we're dropping like flies.
Yeah.
Everybody getting hurt. Everything. We had started the season. Like, crap. Like, this is, like, this is not the way to start the year. With boom, boom, boom. I mean, of course, Byron Buxton laid out for a ball and hurt himself. That was the most obvious one. We all saw that one coming. I mean,
but he was in the best shape.
I think when I was typing that that text out to you, Samantha, I believe that my phone, all I did was type Byron and it finished the entire sentence. Like, it already knew by typing Byron, it meant Byron Buxton's already hurt. Yes, obviously. That's what I meant.
That's because, I don't know, how many years have we been friends? Because we've probably been exchanging that text for either that length or however long Byron Buxton's been in the league, whichever one is longer.
Yeah.
Probably
like,
both.
How do you,
yeah.
Can you imagine front office as you see him diving? You're like, no, God dang it.
He's so interesting.
Like,
and why?
it's, you know, I don't know. I mean, yeah, like this injury bug, we always have a team get hit with the injury bug, and maybe it's Minnesota's turn because they can't get out of spring training quick enough. Something is in the water down there or whatever on the field. I don't know if the Jets put the field together or what it is. Like, they've got to get out of here. This is not, like, they can't. I mean, this is the number of injuries that you see in every team in, like, August when your body is just exhausted. The season's not even started, and the Twins are getting hurt.
Yeah, they still got Correa's German Shepherd leg time bomb too.
I'm going to be thinking about how the people from MetLife probably came down and like did the grounds crew work in Fort Myers for the Twins. I'm going to be thinking about that now. I don't think this team was it before the injuries. That they just cut too much payroll and the rotation took too big of a hit. The pitching has really had so many setbacks for a team that did not look impressive even a year ago. There's just war of attrition. Like I have a few candidates for who will win this division, but the Twins are not at the top of my list, and they weren't even before all the injuries.
I don't know how I feel about this, but I just got a pop-up ad on my computer that's for dental powder for dogs.
Is it for Carlos Correa's ankle?
I don't want to know. I really don't want to know. Why I just had that pop-up ad. It's just weird timing for something like that. All right, Samantha, over under 84. I think I know the answer from both of you, but I still have to ask.
Yeah, I mean, while I agree that 84 wins probably wins this division, I do not think the Twins will be over 84 wins. I will take the under on that.
Irby?
Yeah, this current roster, I'm going under as well. Royce Lewis isn't going to hit 80 home runs.
No. I'm also taking the under. I think the fan grass projection here is quite wrong, but you know, we'll see. All right, projected for second place, Samantha, are those Cleveland Guardians, and you know, this is opposite of the Twins here because the Guardians seem to feel pretty good going into the season.
Yeah, I mean, they've had some unfortunate things happen with injuries as well, although not nearly to the same catastrophic extent. And we like this team better than we like the Twins coming in, even. And there's another one we're going to get to in a minute. But, yeah, I mean, the big thing with the Guardians right now is that the vibes are immaculate. Like, they are so stoked to be there. Everybody showed up 2 weeks early for spring training, the whole team. I have never seen a group of people who look happier to be out there. Like, it's, like, the dead opposite of, like, I mean, we'll talk about the White Sox in a minute. But, like, I saw a game the other day between the Guardians and the White Sox, and it was like watching people who look like they were out there and like they were having the best day of their lives play against some people who all looked like they would rather be dragged out behind the stadium and shot. It was quite jarring to see the difference. But yeah, I mean, the vibes are immaculate. The team really, really kind of coming to life under the new stewardship of Stephen Vogt. Really, really excited about that. I don't know. I don't know if this team really has what it takes to win the division, but it is a bad division, and I think they're probably right up there with, well, we'll talk about the other one in a minute, but I mean, you can't beat the vibes right now in spring training. You're feeling about as good as you can, even with a couple of sort of unfortunate pieces of information coming out in terms of pitching injuries.
See, I mean, Irby, that's what you want to hear from spring training, right? I mean, look, it's a long year. Everyone wants to get off to a good start and all that fun stuff. But how the team is feeling, I think, is just as important. And when you can break camp feeling that good about not just yourselves, but your chances in this division, you're off to a great start already.
Yeah, and this is such an interesting topic because it's not an actual verbiage. It's a feel. It's a look. It's a feel. It's a vibe. It's not best shape of my life, feeling better than ever, you know, renewed, whatever, all that stuff. That's not what it is. A vibe. It is, and it takes watching a today. It takes following the team and understanding, you know, how things are going in the clubhouse. You know, whether it's chess, whatever it takes, like that's whatever it takes. It is a vibe. It is a mindset. And I mean, you said the two teams perfectly there. We'll get into the other one. That's the other spoiler for the few people might be hanging on. When she's hinted already at this other team, it's not the White Sox.
No,
if you're that Chicago fan hanging on, it's not you.
It's yeah, you might
go ahead and bail.
But hey, but
not you.
But,
sorry,
but stick around because your prediction is going to be a little bit fun. It's going to be a little bit fun, yeah. And I'm not saying in a way that we're going to pick on you or your it's just going to be fun.
I enjoy looking up and down this roster and just seeing some of the names on here and the fun that it's going to be. I mean, Samantha, y'all going to have to hire somebody just to keep Austin Hedges and the Naylor brothers.
Oh, my God, like, I can't wait for right that.
That's just going to be fun. It's going to be fun to watch.
Yeah, like no joke, because you know, obviously I'm in Texas now, so I don't have to get MLB TV. The one draw that almost made me pull the trigger on it was so I could watch Hedges and the Nailers. But can we call that the show, Samantha? Can that be the sitcom for the season? Hedges and the Nailers?
They are a sitcom. Yeah, they are a sitcom. Like, there's the theory going that there were, like, five different groups of people who exist in baseball. Like, there are only five types of baseball player, and, like, Austin Hedges hits, like, three of the subcategories. Like, partier, suburban dad, nerd. Like, he's hitting three of five, which is, like, super impressive. So, and he's a little crazy, and, like, you know, Josh is a little crazy. Bo, not so much. Bo is much more reserved. Like, clearly there was only room for, like, one clown in that family. But, like, they are just delightful. Like, it is just so much fun to watch them. Like, and Hedges, oh, my gosh. Like, I mean, thank that guy. If you want to talk about why the vibes are so good, thank that guy. Mm-hmm. Like, he is contagious. Like, he's insane, but, like, in the best possible way.
Oh, quite hilarious.
Have you ever seen anyone drink that much beer during a chess tournament?
No. I haven't.
I mean, listen, I've never watched a chess tournament before.
Neither have I.
Existed, but like, I also assume this is the first time someone has got so hammered that they pass out during a chess tournament. So
yeah, normally you
just
beer
throwing that out
being
there.
Forced to watch a chess tournament, but here it's different.
Yeah, yeah. It's weird stuff happening here.
Hey, weird stuff happening. If you can have fun with a chess tournament, then you're a pretty special dude. And hey, you know what? It took a very large amount of beer, but he got it done. So,
listen, man, this is why I love this team. Like, I could not have imagined ever watching a chess tournament, even with a gun to my head. And I was so excited to see this, and I watched the whole thing because that's how awesome these guys are. So, whether they do well or not, they sure are likable.
They sure are. All right, Irby, anything you want to add here?
No. Hopefully, I just stay healthy and a good fight. Like, it's, you know, we make fun of the Twins and everything, but I do hope that we get a good battle here between these two and mystery team to come, not named Chicago.
I don't think you eliminate. You can also eliminate one of the other ones just in your head for being a baseball fan. All right. The over under here, Samantha, is 79 for the Guardians. Where are they going to land?
Over. I mean, I get that the 84 would have been tough, right? Because right. We think 84 is probably going to win this division. So they win the division, but they finish second. Like, I don't know. Like, I'm pretty sure you could win this division with that mark. But, like, 79, nah, man, they're going to be better than that unless everybody gets hurt again, which I doubt. So, and I'm knocking on wood as I say that.
I would hope so.
We're taking our turn. Apparently, it's the Twins' turn now to have a catastrophic injury season. But, yeah, I'll take the over on that. I feel good about that.
Yeah, you know, and not for nothing, one of those, Irby, you mentioned the nobody saying they're the best shape of their life. Byron Buxton said that. Going into spring training. How about you? What's your over-under here, Herbs? 79.
Of course we did. 79. I'll take the over as well. This is above 500 team.
Yeah, I agree. 100%. Okay, let's get to mystery team, Samantha, which I don't think is a mystery to anyone now that we've kind of eliminated certain people. The Detroit Tigers are projected to finish second or third in this division, depending on how you want to look at these projections. So how about we talk about their, I don't want to say chances, because I don't think they're ready yet. I don't think they're quite there to go for the division, but they could be a dark horse. And I like what they're building in Detroit for maybe not this year, but the year after that, and the year after that, if they, as long as they don't screw it up, they're looking pretty good.
Absolutely. I mean, I think this is, first of all, this is the thing that ought to put Cleveland and Minnesota on notice, is if nothing else, this team is coming, right? So they're going to create problems for you in the future. So if there's a time to go for it, it would be now. And also, like, I mean, I don't know. This is the team, as a Guardians fan, this is the team that makes me nervous this year, not Minnesota. Like, I think Minnesota is going to crater, I'll be honest. Like, and I realize it's easier for me to say that because I just hate the Twins, whereas I respect hate the Tigers. So it's like an easier one. But like, I'm being honest here about what I think. I would tell you guys if I thought the Twins were going to take this, and I just don't. But the Tigers concern me, not because I really think that they're ready to run away and grab this division. I'm with you, Bo. I don't think they're quite there yet, but it's possible. We have seen teams. I'm looking at your Texas Rangers. Little bit of a different situation, a different type of building, but we're talking about a team in a similar position, right? Where we say, okay, these guys could be fun. I think they're headed in the right direction. Like, we know you can get there early. We saw Texas do it. We saw Arizona do it.
Sure.
You know, so there's no reason Detroit couldn't do the same, because I think you're right. I think they're not quite there yet, but at the very least, I think they're going to cause a lot of problems for the teams at the top of this division. And that's something, if I'm Cleveland, that I'm a little bit worried about, right? Even if I don't think Detroit can ultimately finish in front of me, are they going to give me a lot of trouble? Like, are they going to take a lot of games from me? That's something you got to worry about. So, but I think it's cool. I love the Cleveland-Detroit respect hate rivalry that takes place in this division when both of the teams are good. So I'm excited. I hope this is how it turns out. Obviously, I don't want Detroit to be too good, because, like, I mean, let's face it, I don't really want it to be competitive, right? I don't want my team to run away with it. Like, you know how I feel about this, right? Like, I don't want it to be exciting. I just want to win if my team's involved. So, but, you know, I think, but this is cool. I think Detroit is building something that we can get excited about.
Sounds like me every 3 years with the A's, Irby. Be good, but just not to be. Don't be too good.
Right? Too annoying. Sticking around. Always there. Shit.
Where are you at with the Tigers, Irby?
This is definitely a team that can make some noise. There's some youth. There's some young players that we've been talking about. There's others that you're going to get to know the names, like Cole Keith and Jace Young, the younger brother of Josh Young, for those Rangers that you just mentioned. And that's just a handful. I mean, this is Scooballs. This is a big year that I think we all expect almost. I think he's at that point where you kind of expect him to take that step forward. They've had a couple other young pitchers like Mize and Manning where it hasn't really been happening, but if they all continue to move forward and you've got some veteran arms in there and Flaherty and Maeda, like, it's not the worst formula. I know, it's like, I can't even, that's one arm. But you also need guys like that just to keep, like, Kenta Maeda and Jack Flaherty, the kind of pitchers, they're going to keep you in a game competitively. Obviously, if you're not scoring, you're going to lose, but they're not going to blow the handles off and you only go two innings, give up six runs. They're going to keep you in there, and that's what you need. You need those inning eaters. you need those veterans that just nothing huge, nothing great, nothing bad. It's just the same thing. You know exactly what you're going to get from them. And that's what Detroit, you mix that in with some of that youth, and yes, there is a formula there. Now they've got a glaring hole at shortstop because you've got Javier Baez, who is 0 for spring training. So obviously you got to fix that. But outside of that, yes, this is not. And I think this is one where the discussion kind of goes, is what we've been kind of hinting at, is that if the Twins, like you said, Samantha, if the Twins crater, if the Guardians have injury issues and don't take a step forward, and we bring that number, what we're talking about, is that number 84? Is that number 79? If a sub-500 record wins this division, then somebody like these Tigers are absolutely in this conversation. And that's what's intriguing about these three teams, is that if Cleveland and, you know, Minnesota's defending champs, you have to do it, but if, say, it's Cleveland, then they do what they're supposed to do and continue to push forward, Detroit won't be there in the end. They'll be around come summertime, but they won't be there in the end. But if neither of those two teams that have been at the top for the last few years take care of business, Detroit will hang around, and I don't know. It'll make for a fun July. It'll make for a fun trade deadline.
You know, normally when you list off that many ifs, I immediately write the team off as not a playoff contender. True. But in this case, I mean, you could see quite a few of those coming, especially the Twins cratering. I think that's almost a certainty. But some of the other stuff, I mean, you could see that happen. Samantha, how about you? Any thoughts here? Any more thoughts, I should say?
No, I was going to, I have a question mostly for Irby, but really for either of you. So, I mean, where are we at on Casey Mize, right? Like, this is the thing that I keep wondering about. Like, I don't know. Like, are we at the point where we kind of have to give up? Like, and obviously, I have a vested interest in it's not doing well, but I'm not going to root against a kid like that. So, like, I'm just curious. Like, it was so promising until it wasn't. And I don't know. I don't feel great about him.
No, like it's so weird at this point. It's one of those things that we've had around for a while. We've talked about this a while. He's just not getting it done. Sure that. The spring training numbers are good. Yeah, well, it's spring training. Like, we're working on stuff. You're going against minor league hitters at times. It just depends on what game you're pitching. The weirdest thing, you know, like, we talked about Scooball. I was throwing that name out. This is someone I expect to take a step forward. Casey Mize is younger than him by a year. Mm-hmm. Mize is only 26. So, yeah, the beautiful thing here for Detroit is that if he's finally putting it together, then you know what? You're putting it together at the right time, and you didn't have this. Because if he put it together last year at the deadline, we might have seen this as a deadline deal or an off-season trade. But no stock whatsoever, so you're absolutely keeping him. And I'm not saying Detroit was looking to trade him by any means. But we're at that point now where, yeah, if Mize can take that step forward, and the beautiful thing for him is he doesn't have to be the ace. They need him to step forward and be a two guy at best, at least a three. If he can do that, then yes, absolutely, this team is going to be around. So, Mize, it's the same. It's weird because it does feel like one of those names, like a Jerkeson Profar. Like, mm-hmm. Wow, we've been talking about this guy for forever, but he is just 26.
Plus, Profar did eventually figure it out. Like, he didn't turn out to be the top star he was going to be, but he's certainly a serviceable player now.
And that's all the Tigers need. They need Mize to be somebody that can go out there every fifth day, take the ball, throw. You know, not he doesn't have to go throw a shutout, but if he can get them a quality start, like that's the goal, a quality start every time out there. Yes, this is very serviceable. This is very doable, and those are the things that have to happen for this Tigers team to shock anyone. I mean, because we're talking about it, but definitely make some noise and move forward. And get themselves back into a point where they're competitive in the Central.
I don't know, Samantha, like, it's not going to shock us, obviously, because of how we're talking about the Tigers here, but I do think it would shock other people that aren't paying close attention.
Yeah, I think anybody outside of the division, if you're a casual fan and your rooting interests do not lie in the AL Central, I think this will come as a bit of a surprise.
Yeah.
I mean, well, look what happened with Texas last year, right? Like, we stood mm-hmm. there right there and saying, and you guys were wrong about things all the time, but we weren't wrong about that. We said, like, we think Texas is coming, and people were like, I think Texas is going to finish last. And mm-hmm. we were like,
Hey, double down on yourself. You started last year to talk about Arizona as well.
That's true. You did. Yeah.
Yes. No, I had a good year for predictions. I should have gambled like you. Everyone wants me to.
But that's the, apparently, that's the beautiful thing about baseball right there. If we made good points. It is true that things aligned well for Arizona and Texas, obviously. But a year ago today, if I'd have been on here telling you Arizona-Texas World Series, you guys be going, maybe a year too early. Like, we weren't saying they're World Series, but it's these teams are moving forward. They're going to take the steps forward.
Mm-hmm.
Detroit, it's the same thing. The stars are aligning. The players are in position. It is there for them to take a step forward. Mm-hmm. Now, will they maybe take a step back? Yeah, that's possible. That's the agony of sports right there, is that just because it's lining up doesn't mean you go and get it done.
Yeah, look at the Twins.
Now I feel like I have to say that Padre. I do not think Detroit is going to the World Series.
There you go.
You know what? I'm not putting that caveat on anybody after what I saw last year.
Well,
no.
The White Sox are not going to the World Series.
Okay, yeah. I will put it on the White Sox. Yeah. I will do that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure we could find like 7 or 8 teams where we could 100% say they are not going to the World Series. Yeah, but it's nice to have more choices. This is what we want.
You know, more competition. In 69, we had the Miracle Mets. If we get the Miracle White Sox this year, I'm just going to assume the world is ending.
I do not think those two things are comparable.
No. Well, the teams definitely aren't. All right. Over under on the Tigers, Samantha, is 79 wins. Where are you at here?
I'll take the over. I think this team is going to finish second in this division.
Okay.
And I will take the over.
Irby, how about you?
Ooh, that's a good number right there.
It is.
I want to push and just be like, can I get a 79? But I will, talk it up enough. I will take the over. 500 is absolutely obtainable.
Going 81-81.
That's a big, so jealous.
Yeah. Maybe the Rockies really ought to pay attention to the Tigers if they really truly want to be a 500 team. I agree though, Irby. I think 81-81 is the number. So I'm gonna take the over as well. All right, let's get into the Kansas City Royals, because obviously the FanGraphs isn't going to pick the Royals last. So let's talk Kansas City here, Samantha. They are trying to build, obviously, around Bobby Witt Jr., considering the amount of money they're paying him, which, throughout the rest of baseball is kind of like being a part of the average. But for the Royals to spend this kind of money, it's a big deal, right? And it makes me wonder, because they're trying to get a new stadium, even though they just remodeled Kauffman Stadium. Now they're trying to get a new stadium. Did they do this just to grease the gears with the community so they can get the everything they need in place to get this new stadium?
I don't think that's 100% of the reason for the Bobby Witt contract, but I do think it's part of why it happened right now. And I think it's a lot of the reason for a number of other signings they made that felt a little bit inexplicable. Like, why are you signing this expensive person to a short-term contract when you're not competitive? So, yeah, I mean, I think it's pretty clear what's going on here. I mean, whether Bobby Witt would have gotten the extension, like, obviously, I think the answer to that is probably yes. But, and you're playing a game. The better it gets, the more expensive that extension gets, and the less likely he is to sign it. But I also wonder, too, if it's like when you put it together with the other sort of like, mysterious spending that they've been doing this year, if the reason that they pushed to get this done now, as opposed to, say, next season or at the end of the year or what have you, is because they do have a secondary agenda here. It makes sense. I mean, I'm a little bit confused as to why they feel they need a new ballpark. But, that Kauffman Stadium is not that old. It has, as you pointed out, been recently remodeled. It's not really in that bad a shape. I mean, I know everybody wants the ballpark, right? When we have, several people threatening to move over it. But yeah, I think it's, one way to, and I, by the way, I'm not necessarily against this. Like, it's, if you want to get taxpayer money mm-hmm. to build a ballpark, you might want to let your taxpayers know that they're actually going to get something in exchange for that money. Mm-hmm. And in the case of sports, I mean, something that's going to try to do the job that it is paid to do, which is win baseball games. So, I mean, I think there are situations where this happens and it's, you feel like it's a bit disingenuous. Our time here today. And you think that, oh, they're going to spend a bunch of money now, and then they'll slash payroll as soon as they get the stadium. But I don't really think that's what they're doing here. I think they're pushing in as much as they can to let you know, hey, we want you to care about building the stadium for us, so we're letting you know that we care about you. And the Royals have done a pretty good job of operating that way. You know, go back to the Salvi Perez contract. Hey, we're not competitive, but we can keep this guy who you love. Like, I respect it. I don't know if it's the smartest way to build in terms of, you know, this team's mess. They're a mess. Mm-hmm. I'll put that out there. The farm system is still kind of a mess. So I don't know that this is the most practical way to build a baseball team, but it is a means to an end. And I have to tell you, from a fan satisfaction standpoint, I don't hate it.
Yeah. I'm going to give you guys a second over under here. Just because this Bobby Witt Jr. contract was so out of character for Kansas City. Over under, Samantha, for what year they trade him in this contract. When are they going to move him? I'm going to set the over-under at 4 years.
Okay, I think this depends entirely on when the ballpark gets approved. Right?
Fair,
because you can't trade him the year after you get your funding approved. Or, like, people will show up and burn down the original stadium. So you can't do that. So I'm going to go with the over, because if you figure if it takes them at least 2 years to get the funding approved, and then you'd have to sit on it for a year, you'd be right at four. Oh, see, is that why you said it at four? That's smart, actually. That was really good.
You're welcome.
Because, yeah, right at four, right? All right, I'll take a tick over then. I'm going to take a tick over that.
All right, Irby, thoughts here, and give me your over-under on 4 years for the trading of Bobby Witt Jr.
Oh, man, I'm going to go over as well. Like, it'll go later into. They won't do it right away. But, yeah, this is, I mean, Samantha, to your point, that's going to be real interesting of, like, the Kansas City taxpayers. Are they about to have to buy a football and a baseball stadium? Like, do you get some kind of discount on that? Like,
that's
a few billion dollars. That's
going to be a hell of a hotel tax. Like, don't go visit Kansas City anytime soon.
Golly, yeah, that is
35% tax on your hotel room.
What are you talking about?
It's not great to have those. Yeah, this Kansas City team, though, Bobby, look, he's fun to watch. I'm real happy about Cole Reagans, he's the ace there in Kansas City, and wish him well. Hashtag flags fly forever. other than that, no, the farm system, not overly impressed. I mean, Nick Lofton will learn that name this year. You know, there's a few other pieces that will be up there, but that's because of what they don't have in Kansas City. Like, you're going to see prospects. Just because you're promoting prospects and they're getting more play time doesn't mean that's a good thing. It just means that you don't have anything to play with. So, yeah, I don't see this. This doesn't look like Kansas City looks in the same position they were 3 years ago. Before they got Bobby Witt Jr. The difference is you now have him and you're paying a ton of money. Great. Awesome. What else are you going to do? Like this is not the NBA. You have to have more than one player.
Maybe ownership with Kansas City can get a second job. You know, they got to pay for this somehow. Get a second job.
I mean, become a Postmate and, like,
there you go.
Drive an Uber.
You can drive an Uber. Drive an Uber, and all routes go past the stadium site, so they can, like, tell taxpayers, "Hey, this is where we're thinking about putting our new stadium." You know, if you guys go ahead and approve this thing. By the way, you know, your pizza's arrived or something. Like, I don't know. They gotta do something. And Samantha, I think the one thing that worries me here, because we've seen this movie over and over and over again, when a team like Kansas City spends outside of their means, all the pressure then is on player development and the guys running the draft, and you can't afford the really good guys at that. So you don't nail the draft, you don't nail player development, and you trade the player 4 years later.
Yeah, I mean, we've said that Kansas City is the only true small market team in baseball. Like, it's, you know, don't be fooled by that label for anyone else. They're perfectly capable. It's so, but they are a little bit limited in what they can do. And it's like, you want to, I mean, I love the sentiment behind it. The idea that, like, look, we just want to put the most competitive product that we can out there. And we want to keep this guy around who you all want to get behind. Like, I love that. Like, I hate mercenary sports. It's why I struggle to watch NBA now. Everybody's on a new team, different year. Like, I can't stand that. Like, I love to see players sign long-term early, even if it's not ultimately going to change things for the team. But when you put that together with, like, these other sort of, like, nonsense contracts that they were signing this year, and the fact that I think we all agree that, like, we're not, you know, I'm not sold on Bobby Witt Jr. yet. Anyway. Like, not at all, you know. I'm not saying I think he's going to be a bust. I'm just saying, like, I don't think he has shown what he would need to show me personally if I was the guy writing the checks, what I would need to do this. And, like, I don't know how familiar you guys, not you two, but the audience is with sort of, like, what Kansas City's farm system looks like right now. And, like, the pitching pipeline is ugly. So you don't really have much in the works, right? Somebody's got to pitch. You gave all your money to this guy.
Mm-hmm.
So how are you going to field a full baseball team full of pitchers if you don't have anything in the pipeline that you can develop, and you spent all your money on a position player, so you can't really buy anything? Like, it's, I don't know. I have a bad feeling that this is like a house of cards that's going to come down.
Yeah. I agree. And to your point, this time last year, Bobby Witt Jr., there was the word bust was floating around.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
One good year does not a megastar make. So I'm with you. I'm with you on that. Irby, anything you want to add here before we get into the White Sox?
I mean, in that case, yeah, let's delay a little bit longer. Like, I don't want to do that. I mean, at least Kansas City's got somebody, right? We can move over to Chicago. Why not?
All right, so we're going to have another round of assigning a president to a sports team.
We have to do the over under.
Oh, you know what? I'm sorry. That conversation went under. The conversation went so long. I missed that part. Okay, over under. Royals 76 wins. They have the Royals 3 games behind the Guardians and Tigers.
I'm sorry, you guys. Like, I feel for you, but 76 is extraordinarily optimistic. I absolutely not. I will take the under. I don't think that's close. Sorry, guys.
Yeah. Irby?
Yeah, under. Definitely under. Mm. Under 70.
Wow. I think they can at least get like 70.
I was going to guess 71, so.
I mean, what did they do last year? Last year they... Oh, I don't have that information. Darn it. Okay, well, moving on. I'm going to take the under as well, but I think they at least get to 70. All right, let's talk White Sox. Let's assign another president, Samantha, because we had a lot of fun with that last week, and this one was just so painfully obvious. So are the White Sox the William Henry Harrison of baseball? Quick historical facts about Mr. Harrison. He's elected president. Takes a walk on a cold day shortly after his inauguration, catches pneumonia, dies 31 days in office. Is that the White Sox? Although, I mean, they could conceivably be eliminated 31 days in.
I was going to say, I mean, there's more to the story, right? But I was going to say you could just stop there and say the White Sox will be eliminated from contention 31 days into the season, and I don't think you'd be wrong. And, like, by the way, White Sox people, we love you. I'm so sorry. This is a great fan base, and I hate that this is happening to you guys. Even as somebody with a team in the division, like, I love when the Indians, Guardians, whoever the hell they are, and the White Sox are both good at the same time. So, like, I hate this for you guys. Like, I have so much respect for this fan base. We are, however, going to have some fun at your expense because your owner is a demon, and your team is in shambles right now. So I'm sorry. I wish this weren't the case. But, like, good old William Henry, who went out without a hat.
And a coat.
And then, and a coat, which is essentially what Jerry Reinsdorf is doing, right? Like, I've stripped this thing of all its assets, and I'm just going to go out there, and then, you know, William Henry Harrison's probably wondering how he ended up dead after all that, and this dude's wondering why nobody wants to give him a new stadium. Okay, like, if you want to look at, like, the juxtaposition of this against the Royals, like, I mean, it's very transparent what the Royals are doing, but, like, this guy's doing nothing, right? Like, this guy's like, I have destroyed this team. Where's my new ballpark? Like, in what universe, Jer? In what universe does that get you a new ballpark? Like, this is just completely insane.
One other part of the William Henry Harrison story that I think also fits here, Samantha. At one point, he was taking medication for, and I'm quoting this, fatigue and mental anxiety. I need that on an injury report at some point this year. So-and-so is on the 10-day IL because of fatigue and mental anxiety.
Okay, this is like when an actress gets hospitalized for fatigue and you know either they're in rehab drying out or they have an eating disorder. That's what this is, right? Like, this is what Tim Anderson probably would have landed on the DL with, like, last year, right? Fatigue and mental anxiety. Like, I lost a fight, so I have to go on the DL with fatigue and mental anxiety. It makes sense. Sadly, not on the White Sox anymore. Still.
Well, okay. And Harrison, this is my last fact before we really get this. Harrison went out with a bang. After he's diagnosed with pneumonia, he's administered opium and brandy with wine.
Yum. Opium and brandy. What could go wrong? Wow.
And the wine. Don't forget the wine.
And wine. I mean, yeah, and we are, for the record, this is the 1800s, not the 1300s. Like, we're not at the point where you have to drink wine because you can't drink the water. So, like, this is just more on top of more. Like, wow. I mean, but I don't know, guys. Opium? I mean, opium.
And, you know, this is 1841, so you know that's, like, pure opium, right? Like, it's not cut.
No, we're at, like, peak, like, opium den, like, sneak down to, like, the flop house and, like, I mean, there had to have been one in D.C. too. Like, I'm thinking of more like Chinatown at Five Points in New York. But, like, we're going to gangs in New York this, you know? Like, I mean, I realize this is, like, controlled opium or whatever, but was it really? But was it, you know? Like, was there some way to dose this? Like, no, this is like Dorothy falling asleep in the poppy fields in Wizard of Oz. Like, I don't know, maybe you'll wake up, maybe you won't. I guess it's not a terrible way to go, but, like, I mean, are we going back to, you know, last week's, you know, 4 out of 5 Yankee doctors, like, 4 out of 5 opium doctors recommend, like, what is an opium doctor, really? I mean, but... I'm not a medical professional.
I'm not
listen to anything I say.
Yeah, and Irby, it happened so fast that the First Lady of the United States in those 31 days had not moved into the White House yet. She never lived there. She never actually lived in the White House. I mean, like, there's so many different parallels here with the White Sox team that's going to be out of the race on April 1st.
Yeah, absolutely. And Samantha, to your point, yes, you're not a medical professional, but compared to what the advice he was getting, you're doing better than what Willie got.
True story.
1840s.
Yeah.
I would not recommend just
opium,
like,
brandy, and wine.
Some
I'd be like,
opium. Yeah. I feel like I could have been a doctor in 1841 or whatever it is.
Yeah. Tell you what, you keep the brandy, the wine, and take this leech, and then it would have been fine.
See, I was going to bring up the leeches, Irby.
This is so medieval. Like, I just, medical care really advanced rather slowly.
Yeah.
It's evident every time you look at something like this, and you're like, wow, they got out the leeches at, like, less than 200 years ago. That's, wow, that's something.
But that's the, you know, that's the thing, and that's what's happened, unfortunately, to the White Sox, is that they have progressed slowly ever since hiring everyone related to or knows Manny Machado. Even though they never got Manny Machado, they got everyone else. But ever since then, it's been a slow roll of getting back to this thing. And there's some hope. There's some pieces there that are going to be there when they turn it around. But no, there's not a lot of, what we heard today, Michael Soroka was announced as the number two pitcher. And I'm like, that's not a good thing. That's a 4-5 guy.
And aren't they, I believe now, considering what's happened with Kansas City, aren't they the only remaining team that has never given out a $100 million contract?
Yep, that is correct. That is correct. And
not that I'm advocating you give it to anyone who's on that roster right now. I want to make sure I'm clear about that. But, you know, you could pay someone from somewhere else to come in and help you. You could, if you can get anyone to come.
Well, and I love what this team too. Y'all were talking about the, you know, was it the fatigue and mental? What was the injury, Dick and Nate? You wanted both fatigue and mental.
Fatigue and mental anxiety.
Mental anxiety. Okay, not as though we really care about this individual, but the ideal candidate for that will probably be their new catcher, Martin Maldonado, after spending the last few years in Houston.
Yeah.
Now, part of that, he's probably going to be struggling. But too bad.
Let me get out my tiny violin.
Yep.
All right. Anything else here before we do the over-under, Samantha, on the William Henry Harrison of baseball?
No, I'm sorry. I got really distracted because I was trying to figure out what the other kind of anxiety is. They've designated mental anxiety. Like, what is the other option?
That's a good point. What other anxieties are there? Is it all mental?
Yeah, isn't that the whole definition of it? Like it's probably redundant to say mental anxiety, right? It's like, what is the other kind?
Well, it's probably stuff that White Sox diehards will be dealing with here soon as the season starts.
Is it in the opium?
Yeah, there you go.
It's definitely in the poppies. Yeah, 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 absolutely, absolutely. All right. Over-under, Samantha, 67 for the White Sox.
Yeah, take the under and the opium. I'm sorry, guys. It's going to be rough out
together,
there.
Together, that's a rough combination.
You need the opium when the under is 67.
That's a fair point. All right, Irby, how about you?
Oh, yeah, I'm under as well. This team's going to be competing for the highest percentage of a first-round pick next year.
Interesting, interesting. Okay, I'm going to take the over.
Really?
And I'm only going to take the over because William Henry Harrison was 68 when he died.
There you go. I can't argue.
I love it.
So I'm going to so they're going to get one more than 67. They're going to get 68.
I really hope that happens now. Incredible. Love it.
All right. Let's move on to the National League Central, which is also not going to be a great division, and that's being nice. Cardinals are projected to finish first. This is going to be, according to Fangraphs, it's going to be a very tight division with first and last place separated by 6 games. So that's fun if it happens. Let's hope that happens. But for now, the Cardinals are projected to win the division. Samantha, if it was 10 years ago with this roster, I think it would be a no-brainer they'd win this division. This is more of a returning to form in a bad division. Am I right?
Yeah, I mean, I know we've had some fun at the Cardinals' expense this offseason about, like, why they are trying to build a team out of people who were really good, like, 8 years ago. But I still think they're the best team in this division. Last year was an off year. A lot of weird stuff happened. But I don't think that you will see a repeat of they are really, really good at just staying the course and waiting for other people to have problems and then pouncing. So to me, it's like, I think we're right back to, you know, return to form for the Cardinals, where they're going to be kind of wishy-washy in the first half of the season. They'll be hanging around the Rays, probably not in the lead, and then just waiting for other people to make mistakes, have injuries, go into a slump, and then they will take over in the second half as they normally do. So, you know, you had your down year. I think that's done now. I don't see anybody else in this division who looks like they're going to race out there and grab it. So anytime this division doesn't have a strong contender, I always roll with the Cardinals because it's the easy pick.
Not only is it the easy pick, I mean, God, it's like, it's pretty much the most accurate pick you can make.
Right? Well, that's what I mean.
Right.
Like, because you're probably going to be right. If nobody else is elite, pick the Cardinals, you'll probably be right.
I mean, you talk about gambling. Isn't the National League Central the one division where you could probably execute a perfect parlay pretty much every year?
parlay?
Yeah, you could parlay it.
Like three teams?
Yeah. I got three team parlay. Oh,
pick the first three?
Yeah.
I think so. You're right. I think it's an easier division to predict. It's not like it's the same three teams every year, but the first two are pretty easy to pick. I feel pretty good about the third one too. So yeah, no, I think that's right. I think this is an easier division to do that with. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. Again, please don't spend all your money gambling on baseball.
Herbie, how about you?
They won't have anything left for opium.
you gotta save some of your lunch money for opium. I mean, my goodness.
Yeah. What are you going to get more joy out of? The 2 seconds of placing the bet or the 10 hours you will be passed out in the opium den? I don't know, man. Kid, don't do drugs. Just don't bet on the back end of the NL Central. That's the more you know.
Okay, Irby, how about you? Where are you at here with the Cardinals?
I wholeheartedly agree. Before going on my negative here, I wholeheartedly agree with you guys about this. Is like when there isn't anyone running away, the safe bet is the Cardinals. This is a team that there is some enough veteran status, and that's going to be the issue here. There's almost too much veteran. Like there's some fun youth. I expect Mason Wynn to take another step forward. It can't hurt that he is getting to spend every day hanging out with Brandon Crawford. Like that is exactly the kind of relationship you want there. Of what you hope Wynn can develop into. But my only real big concern with these guys is, look, yes, you've got some solid veterans in that rotation. Sonny Gray's the young one. Like between Gray, Mikolas, Lynn, and Gibson, Sonny Gray's the youngest. Like that is an old lineup, and they're going to any need. Like these guys are going to go out there every day and get the job done, but it is the ideal thing to get through a season and potentially win this NL Central that we're about to go through. If nobody wants to grab it by the horns and run away with it, that is the kind of rotation that can just kind of got us there. Hey, we got there. So I'm not betting against that. It's just, I don't know. I'm looking up and down that thing, and I'm like, my gosh. And then they got Crawford, I mentioned already, Matt Carpenter, like Goldschmidt as well. Like, you got a bunch of guys born in the 80s. And I'm not trying to age us here, but that's not what you need nowadays.
Yeah, but you did age us, you bastard.
I know.
God. All right, Samantha, the over-under on the Cardinals is 83 wins.
Oh, I'll take the over.
Yeah, Herbie?
Yeah, I'll go over as well. Not by much. I don't think in mid-80s is what it'll take. But, yeah, I'll go a little over.
Yeah, I don't think there's a 90-win team in this bunch. But I think they do better than 83. So, I agree. All right. Samantha, we got to go talk about the Cubs now. So, obviously, they make some late moves to get some guys back. But it seems to me that they really, really, really think that Craig Council moves the needle in Chicago.
Yes.
Which way?
I don't think that needs to be specified, but sure.
So okay.
I mean the Cubs brass must think it moves in the positive. I don't know.
Yeah. If there's ever been like a thing I do not understand that people have just like taken and swallowed without asking questions, it's like the cult of Craig Council. Like, I'm not saying he's a bad manager, but what kind of press does this guy have? Who does he have photos of? Who does he know at the top of the pile that got this guy who has managed a mediocre baseball team to mediocre success, has never reached a World Series, and as near as I can tell, has not managed in such a way that made me think it was him that was the whole reason for their success. And yet this guy was the guy where people were like, there's going to be a bidding war over Craig Council. And you're like, it's a manager, man. This isn't the NFL. Like, it's a manager. Mostly their job is to fill out a lineup card and not screw up the vibes in the clubhouse. Like, possible to be so bad as a manager that you can tank a team, but mostly your job is to stay out of the way and be like baseline competent. So whoever decided this guy was like the god among men of managers, it's baffling to me. I will never understand it, that you're willing to screw over poor David Ross, like, so you can get this guy. And it's like, okay, poached him from somebody in the division. Like, yeah, Milwaukee's going to be bad, but that's not why. Like, I don't understand this at all. And I'm not saying he's going to make the Cubs worse. He probably won't. I just have a lot of questions about why on earth you think Craig Council would make them better.
Now, what's interesting about that take, though, you look at, there's been obviously some legendary managers in Major League Baseball. Never a bidding war for any of them.
Yeah, like, because this is all manufactured. It's ridiculous. Like, whatever is going on here, like, we absolutely have had people who, as managers, you would point at and say, that guy makes a huge positive difference.
Mm-hmm.
Like, certainly, you know, Terry Francona would be the first name that would come to mind, mm-hmm. I would think, in recent history. You know, like, we talked about Buck Showalter. We talked about Bruce Bochy. Like, these are guys who, like, their presence really is going to make a difference.
Yeah.
Like, and I would consider all of those people to be a solid tier above Craig Council, who, mm-hmm. again, hasn't won anything. Like, remember how he had, like, a lot of bites at the apple and didn't get any of them? Like, why are we celebrating this guy's, like, ability to maintain mediocrity? I don't understand it. Oh, why? I preferred him in Milwaukee, where I could just be like, there's all the things I hate rounded up into one place. And I'm sure he's a very nice man. Not attacking his characters. Don't come for me, Craig Council fanatics. But, like, this just seems ridiculous to me. But then again, half of the stuff the Cubs are doing, it feels a little ridiculous.
Okay, Irby, how about you? Where are you at here with the Cubbies?
A team that's going to be around. They're absolutely going to be in the conversation. You're led by Justin Steele, who we're learning is a really good pitcher. Kyle Hendricks has taken a step back, but he can still be a guy that goes out there, picks them out every 5 days, and gets the job done. Outside of that, I don't believe in this rotation. I think there's bullpen issues there as well. We are going to see a youth infusion here. A lot of this is another round. We saw this about 5-6 years ago. The Cubs had a bunch of prospects coming up at once, and it worked out well for some, not so great for others, but you're seeing that again now. Pete Crow Armstrong is the one that a lot of people have talked about, and we're going to see. I mean, Michael Bush is another name. We're already seeing some Chris Morrell. Like, there's some good youth here in the field, and I feel like in that lineup out in the field, this is a Cubs team that is going to be fine. It's that rotation that just gives me pause. Like, Justin Steele can't pitch every day. He's going to have to take some days off. And so, I mean, and Bo, you said it, you're moving the needle. This team's got Drew Smyly. So there's
the Mr. Move the Needle. Oh, boy. All right, Samantha, the projection for the Cubs is 82.
I'll take the over on that.
I don't
think this team is going to be exceptionally good, but I think they will be a good team. I mean, I agree with you, Ruby. I think there's going to be some issues with the pitching, but I think they are a better than a 500 team, so I will take the over.
Irby?
Yeah, I've got to do the same thing. It's over on that number. It's not over by much. Mid-80s is a great number, but as what we've talked about, that mid-80s number could get you the division.
You know, I like the Cubs for 84 wins.
Yeah.
I like 84 for the Cubbies. So I'll take the over as well. All right, let's flip it over to those Brewers. Now, they lost a lot off this
roster. I'll take the under. I don't
even know. I'm not there yet. the Brewers... They lost a lot, Samantha, but one of those big losses was Craig Council. Do you think they'll get better without Council there?
There's going to be some kind of, like, there has to be some kind of math, right? So it's like, how much worse, like, okay, you got worse because you got rid of Corbin Burns, and you've also, like, I think made some other, moves that are highly negative. You've done really nothing to help yourselves, right? But, like, are you going to be, like, could we take a couple of wins back because Craig Council is old?
So, yeah.
I don't know. I can't prove it, but I suspect the answer is yes. So, I cannot prove that, but you can't disprove it, Craig Council fans.
Okay, you know what? I think we have to go to Mr. Statistician here, Irby. Irby, I'm thinking, I'm visualizing a formula where we add the wins to the Brewers because Craig Council's not there, and then we subtract because of the losses they've had on the roster, and that gets us the actual number.
It's not a terrible formula, you know, and there is something to that. What can be brought out of some of these guys. I mean, I think it works out great for Milwaukee that they're now promoting Jackson Chirio.
Mm-hmm.
After Council is gone, I just think Craig would look at him and be like, why is this kid here? He's good, Craig. I don't care.
It's like a losing version of Billy Martin.
Yeah, it's, but like, Milwaukee will absolutely take a step back. They know that. Mm-hmm. They're not in that position where they've been moving on from Corbin Burns. You knew that was going to happen. Whatever happens with Woodruff, if we see him again this season or not, I have no idea. So yeah, it's Peralta, Wade Miley, Joe Ross. I mean, just not a rotation that makes you feel, you know, warm and fuzzy like it's going to get the job done. So yeah, this is a different look Brewers team. Let's talk more about the Jacksons of the world. Let's talk more about some of these youth. Let's talk more about what you can keep building here, because this is not a hard reset. From Milwaukee, they're going to have some major pitching concerns in the near future because all their prospects that they're going to be seeing are offensive minded. I think it's Robert Gasser is a left-handed pitcher, and that's really all they have that might come up this year, next year, on the pitching side. So, but they've got some offense, they've got some defense coming up. It's not a hard reset, but it is a step back to look and see where you're going to go next, because now your Council's gone. Like it's almost like Milwaukee needs to kind of go through a rebranding.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. The years of Council, the years of, we go back to Prince Fielder, Ryan Braun, you've still got Yelich, that, like, you almost need to step away from that era and become something other than what we've had so much fun laughing at the last 5-6 years.
All right, Samantha, the Brewers projection is for 80 wins.
Under.
Irby?
I mean, I already said that, but yes, I will confirm that I am taking the under, because I think this team is not going to be bad, but they're not going to be competitive. So, and I think they're the fourth place team in this division. We're talking about a third because that's where the Fangraphs odds landed them, but I actually think they're the fourth. They finished fourth.
Irby, how about you?
Yeah, I'm under as well. I'm the same fourth place team. I don't see this going. This isn't going to go well.
Yeah, I agree. I'm taking the under with the Brewers as well. All right, let's get to the Reds next. The Reds are projected to finish fourth, which I don't disagree with. I do disagree with. I think they finished third. The Brewers are the fourth place team. Samantha, I think with the Reds, this is interesting, right? Because we just talked about the White Sox and how just mired in awfulness they are right now. That was the Reds a year ago. So I guess my question, did the Reds like hire a poltergeist and cast their demons from last year onto the White Sox?
I want to know who the last team the Reds played in spring training last year was, because all I know was the vibes were at an all-time low during spring training for this team a year ago, right? Like, their owner just couldn't shut up, like, right, alienating the fan base. I mean, you guys, somebody crapped in the equipment truck on truck day when it was leaving, like, which is disgusting. And, like, I hate that. It's appalling to me that people do things like this. But it is, I think, a good encapsulation of exactly how the fans were feeling. And I don't disagree with the way that they felt about it. I mean, symbolically speaking, that is the correct way to feel when your ownership is treating you the way that Reds ownership was treating them. So, like, all-time low, right? But then, like, actually things turned out okay. So I don't know, like, if they hired an exorcist and, like, the poltergeist just left and then it latched on to the next thing that it saw. Because if I'm telling you, if the Reds played the White Sox in the last series of spring training last year, I'm going to feel really good about this theory. Like, they got rid of it, but they failed to contain it. Like, this is my understanding of how this works, right? I've been reading a lot about ghosts lately because I'm trying to bring my dog back to life. Long story. Not going to get into it here. But anyway, I'm trying to get my dog's spirit back. Mm-hmm. So I've been reading a lot about this lately. And my understanding of poltergeists, which are different than ghosts, I'm, like, less well-educated on you guys. I don't know what I'm talking about. But, you know, I think that they, if you don't banish them properly, they will just relocate slightly. So leave it to the Reds to incorrectly exercise something. I mean, it worked out okay for them, right? But, like, they didn't actually, like, banish the poltergeist, like, into another dimension. They just kicked it down the road to, like, whoever was in the way. And I think it latched onto the White Sox and it went home with them. This is the only logical explanation for this.
That's a hell of a gift for the Reds to give the White Sox, Irby. Like, we're gonna improperly cast this demon out and it's gonna land with the White Sox.
Samantha.
What?
The Cincinnati Reds in 2023, their last two spring training games were the White Sox and the Rockies.
Oh my God. Are you serious?
Ooh.
This is our Cornell conversation all over again. The plot thickens. This is amazing. I swear to you, I did not know that. And he did not know I was going to say that. I promise you.
Nope, I had no idea. Thank you for talking a while on it. Gave me plenty of time to do my research. And which is good. It was good to research and dive in. So there actually was, on the final day when they played the Rockies, there was a split squad game. Against the other game was against the Guardians, but it was definitely a minor league infused type game.
I sound so much less crazy than I did like a minute and a half ago when I was telling you guys about how I'm trying to bring my dog back to life.
All right. Well, okay. The Reds and their new vibes, now that they've cast away their spirit to the White Sox, are projected for 79 wins, Samantha.
Oh. See, 79 sounds about right. Yeah, I think I'm going to take the under, but only by one.
Irby?
I'm an over. I think this is a Reds team that can compete for the division. If the concerns that we talked about with the rotation with the Cardinals and the Cubs come to light, where the Cubs can't find another arm and the Cardinals, the age finally catches up with them, and they have similar concerns, this is a Reds team very similar to what we talked about with the Tigers here, that they can stick around and get the job done. I like some of the youth on this team. I mean, Ellie De La Cruz is just fun to watch. Doing some of the stuff that he can do. They've got some other good players on this team. The rotation, like, yeah, there's some good young arms on here that can get the job done. By no means am I going to sit here and say the Reds win this division, but because this is a division that we're talking about mid-80s might get the job done, the Reds are in the conversation for me then. Like, I think this is above 500, and so because of that, if we're sitting here 82, 83, you're in that conversation come September.
Yeah, I agree with Irby. I'm taking the over, too. And it wouldn't shock me if they won this division.
I hope you guys are right. I'm going to be awesome.
All right, let's get over to those Pirates. I don't know. I mean, it's very cliche, but I got to do it.
Look what I got. I got to do it. I got a jar of dirt, and guess what's inside it?
No, you did not miss losses. The time capsule.
There's losses inside it.
Okay, but here's my question. If we want to go full-fledged Pirates of the Caribbean, does that make O'Neill Cruz Barbosa? Is he Hector Barbosa? Yeah, that's right. Hector Barbosa. Apparently he had a first name, which I thought was Barbosa.
can't get past this Hector thing. Like, I just, that is not that man's first name. I'm sorry. I do not accept that. I wish, like, we talked about this in the meeting. I wish I, or but you said it. I don't want to know that. I wish I didn't know that. Take it out of my brain. I don't want to know that. It's just Captain Barbosa. That is not correct. So, yeah, I mean, we could recast the whole movie with Pirates players and probably do it. It would just be, like, a way less interesting movie than if you recast it with some team that's not the Pirates as the people from the Pirates movie, which is kind of depressing. Because, like, I don't know. It's just, it bums me out. This team has such a beautiful ballpark. Mm-hmm. It's a great fan base.
Yeah.
I mean, Pirates is the coolest possible thing you could call your team. Like, it was, my team was called the Pirates and mm-hmm. the Guardians. Like, it's like the best possible thing. It has the best possible, like, merch tie-ins. There was a man that would sit in the stands there with a parrot there, a real live parrot. I mean, just everything about, like, the way that you could market this team and that ballpark, man. I mean, my husband's from Pittsburgh, so spent a good amount of time there. And it is gorgeous. And this team does not deserve it. Like, it's so disappointing to me that they're squandering all this over and over and over because they won't spend money. And they're a well-run team. That's the other thing that kills me. You know, this team knows how to draft and develop talent. Mm-hmm. It's just that they have to then turn around and trade it away because they're not willing to spend any money. And it's really a bummer because they have so many good things going on there. It stinks for the fans. It stinks because it's a gorgeous ballpark. And it stinks. It's got to be frustrating to work in the front office there because those people are really good at their jobs. And it ultimately comes to nothing. So I don't know. Like, if he's Barbosa, I mean, what is the owner? Is he Davy Jones? He's probably Davy Jones.
Yeah. Actually.
That whole, like, if I can't have anything nice and nobody can have anything nice, like, I want to make everybody miserable because that's what the guy's doing. He's making everybody miserable. Mm-hmm. So that's who he is. He is Davy Jones.
Yeah. Irby, anything you want to add there?
this is a team that it's all about the future. It's not happening now. This is going to be a close division. If they get off to a hot start, sure, there'll be conversations. Oh, are they in this? No, they're not in this. They won't be there in the end. This team doesn't have the draw. They don't have the team to be there in the end. Could they down the road? Yes. I mean, if Paul Skeens, his arm doesn't fall off in the next few years, yeah, he's going to be a great weapon for them. Tamar Johnson was another wonderful draft pick that they got that's churning out and looking great, and he's moving up through the minor leagues well and might be an awesome combination with O'Neill Cruz up the middle. Brian Reynolds, we've talked about him. Jack Sawicki is another guy that started stepping up. So the pieces are there. There's going to be some steps forward, but no, until it's not where this division's at, not there yet. This is a team playing for the future, and by the future, I mean 2026 at the earliest.
All right. Well, for the 2024 season, the Pirates, Samantha, are projected for 77 wins.
That seems high. Yeah, I can't get on board with this. And this is the problem with projection systems, is they tend to clog up all the projections together in divisions like this. And it, realistically speaking, and this is one of the flaws of projection systems, is it is very rare for a division to be that tight. They're just not going to be all that close together. So somebody's got to finish at the bottom. Somebody's got to finish further down than that. This is not a competitive enough division to have the last place team finish that high. Also, I don't like what I see on the field from these guys. So, yeah, I'm going to take the under.
Irby, how about you?
Yeah, I'm the under as well. Just, I mean, especially with the Reds saying what I did there of going over. I just don't see the wins being there. Like, no one is a shining star in this division, but there's enough pieces, enough teams that have been there that are going to scratch out wins. But I think this division, there's enough series wins over the Pirates. So, yeah, I got to go under. It won't be terrible. You'll be in the 70s, but mm-hmm. it's not your year, and it's okay. It's not supposed to be your year yet.
Yeah, yeah, I got the under as well. Before we go, we have some breaking stuff, kind of. It's kind of breaking. Because it comes from John Heyman's head. I think John Heyman's being used again because he's reporting the Yankees are back in contact with Jordan Montgomery, which this just feels like Boris and has called up his old buddy John Heyman and said, hey, put this out there.
Yeah, I agree with you. We haven't really seen any, like, legitimate, like, sources reporting any connection. between Montgomery and the Yankees. It's just like, yeah, the Yankees need something. But, like, also, like, the way they're acting, like, they're, like, kicking the tires on guys like, you know, like Michael Rendon, you know. Like, yeah. This is – I don't think – you know, they have made clear that they think that Cole will be able to pitch at some point this season. And I don't think Jordan Montgomery solves the problem either way. Like, I think what they're doing is, like, I think perhaps this is a group effort. The Yankees don't want to put it out there that they're not going to take a chance on something expensive or controversial. Mm-hmm. I don't think they're interested in doing that. I think they're going to roll with what they have unless they can get something kind of on the cheap.
I agree.
So, yeah, I don't buy it at all. I think the original suitors remain in the Jordan Montgomery sweepstakes. I find this very hard to believe. But Boris, you know, it's you know, Heyman.
You never know with Heyman.
I can't even imagine, like, having, when you're done with your career, like, it's like, I say this for the rest of us, like, you know, however much we do or don't succeed, ultimately, by the time we're ready to retire in sports media, I feel good about the fact that I have never acted as a patsy for an agent.
It's, you know what it is? It's the phrase back in contact. That's all Heyman's reporting. The Yankees are back in contact, right? Which is Boris speak for? I need the Yankees in the public discourse so I can try to get this guy something.
Well, and think about back in contact might just mean Boris called and said, right. "Hey, are you interested yet?" And the Yankees said, "No, thanks."
Yeah. Technically speaking, or the reverse, the Yankees called and said, "All right, has he come down from his price yet?" No, okay. Either way, that counts as back in contact, right, Irby? It counts.
Yeah, this is the ultimate. Like, it's just those scam calls that you just see. It pops up on your Apple Watch or your Fitbit, and you just see it's like, oh, it's that guy again. No. But technically, they are back in contact. Like, maybe they just were walking down the street, saw each other. Hey, man, how you doing? Good.
Yeah. That also counts. That.
Yeah, that is technically back in contact. Yeah, this is. This is just like the Blake Snell right before he goes to the Giants. It's the same thing. It's, well, the Yankees and the Astros are talking to him. Okay, just because they're talking doesn't mean anything's going to get done.
Right. And then he goes to the Giants.
Yeah. I mean, my gosh, now that, whatever. Everybody was in, it's whatever.
Whatevs.
Yeah. Keep it up, John. Never change.
Oh, boy. All right. Well, unlike the Jordan Montgomery negotiations, we're done. We'll see when he pitches. It might be the All-Star break at this point. All right. Wherever you're listening to Lollygagging Sports, give us a like, subscribe to the show, leave us a review, hit us up on Twitter, also known as X. But for this week, we're done. We're out of here. Until next week. There is some. I actually looked, guys. I looked at this. I looked all through my guide. There's full-fledged baseball happening this weekend. We're gearing up because this time next week it is opening day eve. So wherever your favorite team is playing, watch them play. We'll see you next week.